Thank you for joining me today. My name is David Lamb. I'm the pastor of Revival Tabernacle, and I hope and pray that this lesson on leadership is a blessing to you. As the pastor of this church, it's my sincerest desire to try to equip each and every one of you all with the necessary tools that will help you become the most powerful, fruitful, victorious Christian possible. And we need leadership in the church. We need godly leadership. We need strong leadership in the house of God. It's very rare in this day. And so I'm hoping that I can maybe share a few things with you that I've learned down through the years through trial and error, and hopefully those things will help you. And so let's just get on into the lesson, and let's look at Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14. The Bible said, "Where no counsel is, the people fall, but in the multitude of counselors, there is safety." Where no counsel is, the people fall, but in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Now in this text, the word courage means steerage, like your hands on a steering wheel. Steerage, probably the visual picture would be a captain. You know, he's guiding that ship. It means steerage or guidance. So what the text is telling us is when you're surrounded by those that can steer, those that can guide, there is great safety. There's comfort in that place. You can find rest and peace. So God places people in our lives to steer us, to guide us. Paul said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." And basically what he is saying is, I can steer you or I can guide you because Christ is guiding me. So I'm going to talk to you leaders for a little while, and particularly the ones that are attached to me in Revival Tabernacle. You're the front lines. You're the face of everything that we do. The people trust you. They lean on you. They look to you for strength and wisdom and help in times of trouble. God has called you to lead in a manner that pleases, and not only pleases Him, but exemplifies Him. You should be Christ to the people. So, are you effective? Is God blessing your ministry? Do people follow you willingly? Do they follow you joyfully? That's very important. Or do you find yourself working alone, frustrated, blaming others for their perceived failures, or perhaps their lack of joy, or lack of burden, or lack of zeal, lack of compassion, lack of love, whatever? Just fill in the blank. Do you take responsibility, or do you blame others? Do you find it hard to get people to follow you? Do you have a difficult time getting people to assist you in fulfilling your vision? And if so, you need to ask yourself why. You need to go to God and ask Him for His wisdom. You know, what I'm getting ready to share with you comes from 20 years of ministry, 20 years of trial and error, 20 years of victories and failures. A lot of what I'm getting ready to tell you, I learned because I tried it and it didn't work out. And so, to my shame, I have had some toxic qualities in my leadership, probably still do. That's why I'm reading and learning and listening, and now I'm sharing some of that with you. Listen to this, and listen to this carefully. If I could summarize leadership in one word, that word would be influence. Leadership is influence, period. There's old leadership proverb that says a leader who is, you know, walking or basically leading without any followers is merely taking a walk. I thought that was, you know, kind of witty, funny, but it's also very true. A leader who has no followers is merely taking a walk. You see, leadership is a man or woman's ability or power to affect someone's beliefs or actions. The leader's influence will be directly connected with their ability to inspire. That's a very important word, inspire. It simply means to fill someone with an urge or ability to do or feel something. We need to inspire people. We need to be able to help fill people with an urge to do or to feel something. The people need to feel something. And it's our responsibility, at least partially, to do that, to inspire. I want to be an inspiration. John Quincy Adams said, "If your actions inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, you are a leader." William Arthur Ward said, "The mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, the great teacher inspires." Isn't that wonderful? And very true. Ministry leaders have a big job. It's very, very difficult. You have to be skillful. In fact, I probably could say that when it comes to pastoral ministry, it's probably impossible in our own wisdom and our own talents. God has to guide us and direct our paths. I know men that were very successful leaders in the business world, but not very good leaders in the church world. And I'm going to tell you the difference. In the business world, they had leverage. That's an important word, leverage. Simply put, if the people under them didn't do what they told them or didn't perform to a satisfactory, standard, they just fired them. They took away their job. They gave them a pink slip. Now, the reason I'm using the word leverage is because if I'm your boss and I can fire you and I can take away your job, I'm doing more than just taking away your job, because you have a spouse, you have children, you have a home, you have a couple of vehicles, you've got a bass boat, you've got a four-wheeler, or whatever it is that you have bills. You have to live, you have to eat, you have to buy clothing and all of these things. And all of that is attached to that paycheck that you get Friday. And so a supervisor, a company owner, a business manager, whoever it is that's in a leadership position, when they know that they have that type of leverage over you, they can just about ask anything they want. And a lot of people, because of that leverage that's over top of them, because they are so attached and so needful of that paycheck, they will bend and they will comply to things that they never would have. And so I guess what I'm saying is, as a leader, when you have leverage, the people underneath you may hate your guts. They have no respect for you. But because they can't afford to lose their job, they obey without question. So what happens is the leader begins to abuse his power with the people. And I just need to tell you that that's not real leadership. That's dictatorship. So that's what I'm saying. Pastoral ministry, this type of leadership is the truest, rawest form of leadership, because the workers and the followers, the people that's assisting us, are all volunteers. If they follow you, it's because they want to follow you. If they follow you, it's because they choose to follow you. If they don't like you as a leader, they're going to just quit. They're going to stop following you. They're going to go to another church. They're going to go back to the pews. They're not going to show up. They're not going to help you. So you have to know what you're doing, or you're going to fail every single time. Most church folk are far too smart to allow a religious leader to abuse them psychologically, emotionally, and spiritually. We have to be careful. We've got to be skillful, godly, holy leaders, all right? We've got to use wisdom. We've got to learn. Now, I want to talk to you about ministry. That's what this is all about. When I talk to you about leadership, I'm talking about leaders who are in place to take the forefront, to guide and steer people into ministry. So they are ministers and they are creating ministers. That's what a great leader is. A good leader creates followers. Great leaders create more great leaders. So, and I think one of the most common errors within the minds and I guess ideology of preachers is that they have been programmed to believe at worst that the pulpit preaching, teaching from the pulpit, is the only ministry. At best, they've been programmed that pulpit ministry is the most important ministry. But you need to understand that a very small percentage of the apostles and disciples' ministry was in the pulpit. Very, very small. They preached and ministered everywhere, every street corner, wherever they could find a sick person. I say hospitals. I mean, they had infirmaries, things of that nature. The pool of Bethesda, the sick were everywhere. Those are the kind of places that they preached, just like Christ. Look at Acts 2, 46 and 47. Bible said, "And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God, and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved." Wonderful set of verses there. We need to understand that ministry is more than a 45-minute sermon from the pulpit once or twice a week, and that's important. I've dedicated a lot of my life to preaching and teaching from the pulpit. That's what the pulpit is. It's a place where we pull men from the pit. We also disciple and educate. It's a very important ministry. But we've got to understand that real ministry is found in the prayer closet. Real ministry is found in walking the streets, reaching the least, the last, and the lost. The lost are not in our churches. They're out there. They're in the alleys. They're in the drug houses. They're out there in the world, and we've got to go find them. Real ministry is found in jails. Real ministry is found in hospitals. Real ministry, my brothers and my sisters, is found in the Great Commission. Let me ask you this. Why are there no small group ministries or cell groups popping up all over this city? And I know what folks will say. Some of you have been raised more of an old-fashioned say, what is a cell group? What is a small group? Oh, I don't believe in that. That's this or that. Okay, all I got to do is change the terminology, and you'll be like, oh, yes. You see, what some people call a house, a cell group or a small group ministry, you call a house church. You know, let's have a cottage prayer meeting. Oh, yes, we need more house church, you know. Okay, why is there not more house churches? Why are there not more cell groups, small group ministries popping up around this city? Why are preachers and ministers and just good solid lay members not holding Bible studies in their local communities? Why are people not opening up their homes, inviting the lost, the unchurched, the disenfranchised to join them from prayer, join them for Bible study? How about some coffee and some donuts and just some good godly fellowship? Why are we not making our homes a church? Why are we not using our houses as a home base for ministry? Why aren't the preachers and ministers creating ministries? Well, there's no room to preach at Revival Tabernacle. If you have that mentality, you need to change. You need to understand that ministry is everywhere. You know, God has called me to pastor Revival Tabernacle. That doesn't mean that I'm going to preach every sermon. I don't. I mean, I do preach a lot, but this is where God has called me. I've got a job to teach, to disciple, and to preach to this people. God called me here to do that. There's no doubt about it. But that doesn't mean that there shouldn't be any preachers up underneath me because I won't let you preach. You see, that's what I'm saying. You're going to get your turn. But why do you have to wait to preach one time a month from a pulpit? Why aren't you busy reaching out and pulling them in, teaching them the gospel, teaching them the importance of a home church and a pastor? You see, when we begin to do that, we begin to make real change. This is hard ministry. It's difficult ministry. So, you know, when we ask, why aren't these ministries popping up? I'll tell you why. Because they're not easy. Those are real ministries, and real ministry is hard. And so with that said, you know, when we begin to look at these small group ministries, cell groups, you know, street ministries, things of that nature, jails, nursing homes, hospitals. It's an incredible ministry because you're able to pour out of what you have inside of you into the hearts of others. You're able to utilize your gifts all the while building the local church. That's the way it's supposed to happen. That's the way the New Testament church did it. House to house, breaking bread, all of those things. They were having church and they had ministry everywhere. And we've got to get back to that. Large meetings on Sundays, Wednesday nights perhaps, but we need to start breaking it down where the saints are reaching their world, not just the church, but reaching their world, bringing people in. And I believe that if the ministers and leaders of Revival Tabernacle would engage their community and their people in their world with these type ministries, we'd double this church every 6 months. There's no doubt about it. Now let's look at some leadership styles. There's a lot of different types of leaderships. Leadership styles and leaders, because there's a lot of different types of personalities. People are different, so we lead different. Some styles of leadership work. Some styles of leadership are just simply toxic. There's no other way to look at it. Very toxic natured leadership, okay? And we have to be able to discern the difference between good leadership and toxic leadership. So let's take a quick look at toxic leadership first, and then we'll move into some more positive aspects. And if you find any of these negative attributes in your life, I want you to go to God. I want you to ask Him for help and wisdom, and you've got to eradicate these things immediately. Toxic leaders are both self-destructive and ultimately collectively harmful because they ultimately weaken and destroy the church or organization structure. Toxic leaders are sometimes referred to as petty tyrants, leaders who exercise a tyrannical style of management, resulting in a climate of fear, intimidation, manipulation in the church or workplace. Unfortunately, far too many pastors, way too many leaders are toxic leaders. We've got to stop this. We've got to correct it. If we're going to go forward at Revival Tabernacle, if we're going to go forward as a body of Christ as a whole, we've got to have proper, loving, gentle leadership. The basic traits of a toxic leader are as follows. They're generally isolated from outside influences. They don't need to learn anything from anybody or anyone because they already know everything they need to know, and the things that they think they need to learn, they're going to teach themselves. It's weird. But that's the way toxic leaders are. They have no outside influences. They lack self-control. They're shallow. They're operationally rigid. They're callous. They're inept. They're discriminatory. They're corrupt and or aggressive. And they often try to convince others that their leadership or their leadership style or ability is superior to their fellow leaders. They seem to tend to, you know, have an attitude that they're more loving, they're more committed, they're more zealous. And basically what happens is they think that they're more intelligent than they really are. They think they're more skillful than they really are. They're always criticizing other staff. They're always criticizing other leaders. And they avoid and dislike, perhaps even hate, to be asked questions about their leadership style. Makes them very uncomfortable. Toxic leaders, and I want to give you a list of maybe 6 traits that toxic leaders possess for sure. There's many more, but 6 major ones that I wanted to share with you. The first one being a toxic leader will fail to act responsible or to accept responsibility for his or her actions, okay? A toxic leader fails to accept responsibility for his or her own actions. Any shortcoming is someone else's fault, period. Toxic leaders will not take responsibility. If something happens, it's somebody else's fault. If the ministry is not successful, it's somebody else's fault. You know, it's either someone else's fault, or if they confess a shortcoming, that shortcoming is quickly lessened by comparing their own shortcoming to someone else's perceived worst fault. And basically what they do is they see a failure in themselves, but instead of just coming full face with it, they cut their neighbor down, which gives them the illusion of rising. It's just human nature, and it's wicked. We gotta crucify that. That's what the cross of Christ is for. We must deny ourselves. We must bring this flesh under subjection. So we either will not confess our faults, or if we confess our faults, we compare our faults to someone else's, what we think is a worse fault. And so, you know, when we're unsuccessful, someone else is always to blame. Number 2, the toxic leader is an arrogant leader. No one else is quite as driven. No one else is quite as talented as them. No one sacrifices more than them. No one does as much as them. The church or ministry couldn't function without them. If bad things happen in the church, it's because they were slighted and God is pouring his judgment out upon the church. So whatever they're doing, the toxic leader thinks that is the center of the universe. This brings division with other leaders. It brings division amongst the ministers of the church. And what happens is the other leaders begin to feel as if this toxic leader doesn't think their ministry is important. The reality is all the ministries are equally important. The people sitting on the pews, they pick up on this and they end up having a bad taste left in their mouth because they don't want to be led by an arrogant, heady, high-minded person. It doesn't suit well in the church. Great leaders aren't arrogant know-it-alls. You need to stress that. Great leaders are not arrogant know-it-alls. They are acutely aware how much they do not know. They have no need to be the smartest person in the room. They have an unyielding desire to learn from others. They'll learn from anybody. They're always wanting to become a better leader, and to become a better leader, you have to learn. I've often said leaders who are not growing cannot lead a growing church or ministry. One of the hallmarks of great leaders is an insatiable curiosity. If a leader isn't extremely curious about every aspect of their church and ministry, you need to trust me, there are going to be huge problems somewhere down on the horizon. Leaders who don't learn, they don't last. That's just as simple as I can say it. Leaders who don't learn, don't last. A good leader has much to learn, and they know that. So listen to me, good leaders are readers. Good leaders are readers. Good leaders are learners. If you're struggling to get people to follow you, you should do some internal examinations. You probably need to repent. I know that I've had to repent over and over and over for my poor leadership skills, because a lot of times it was a reflection of my character, my nature, where I was at spiritually at the time. Okay. So if you are seeing these issues, if you're struggling to get people to follow you, you need to accept that fact. And you need to change some things in your life. You need to accept that you need to change, and you need to find out how to change it. You need to start reading books on leadership. You need to start listening to leadership messages. YouTube is filled up with them. The internet has thousands of books, thousands of messages and lessons. You need to attend some leadership conferences. And I've got five books here that I wanted to bring to your attention. And really, you know, these five books, I would love to see every leader underneath me or attached to me in any capacity read. You need to get these books, and you can purchase them from Kindle, you can purchase them from Amazon, you can purchase them from eBay, very, very cheap. The first one is John Maxwell's 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. It is a masterpiece. Number two, Gene Edwards, A Tale of Three Kings. Probably the most important book that you could possibly read as a leader who is under authority and in authority. That book would probably straighten up a great deal of issues in the churches. The third book that I would like to see our people read is Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People. Number four, John Bevere's Breaking Intimidation. That is a must read for every Christian, but especially ministers. And the fifth book that I think every leader in this church ought to read is Ken Sands, that's K-E-N-S-A-N-D-S, Ken Sands, The Peacemaker, A Biblical Guide to Resolving Conflict. I spelled that Sands. His name is Ken Sand. I was using the possessive. It's Ken Sand. I'm going to put all of these on the screen there so you can see. The Peacemaker, The Biblical Guide to Resolving Conflict. Those are beautiful books. Those five books will give you a major, major jump on where we're needing to go. Now let's look at the third toxic trait of the toxic leader, and that is bullying. A toxic leader bullies, intimidates, they manipulate, and they shame people into doing what they want. They can be frightening. They can be psychologically stressful to work with. You don't want to be that way. You don't want to be one of those guys that shames people, that bullies people, that manipulates people, that you know, twists their feelings and emotions. It's not a productive style of leadership. And yeah, you may get people to do what you want them to do, you know, now in the present. But if you'll fast forward a little while, you're going to see that no one ever continues doing that because no one wants to be bullied. Nobody. You know, when leaders are constantly amazed and frustrated by those who don't, you know, just won't get it. You know what I'm saying? I don't know why they just won't get it. They just won't get it. Well, it's probably not them. There typically exists both a leadership and communication problem. And I'm talking to you from a pastor's evangelist, CEO, vice president, president. I've had all sorts of, you know, leadership titles. When the people don't get it, it's because I'm not telling them in a way that they can get it. I'm not demonstrating it. I'm not illustrating it in a way that they understand. Very seldom is it the people. When the people don't get it, it's usually mine and your fault. And so that's one of those places that we're going to have to take responsibility. Show me a leader with poor communication skills, I'm going to show you a leader that's short-lived in their position. Great leaders can communicate effectively across any medium, constituency, and environment. You've got to work on your communication skills. Great leaders are active listeners. They're fluid thinkers. And they know when to dial it up. They know when to dial it down. And guess what else they know what to do? They know when to shut up. They know when to turn it off. Great leaders know when to bridle their tongue and just listen. Sometimes the greatest counsel that we can give somebody is, yeah, I understand. I know. I've done that for 2 hours, and they walked away and said, that's the greatest counsel I ever heard, because sometimes people need to talk, and we need to learn how to listen. We'll learn a lot. And so stop bullying, stop manipulating, stop pushing and pulling and shaming people, and let's pray. Let's be anointed. Let's have the authority of God upon our life, and let's be able to intellectually reason with people and help them and steer them in a way that God is pleased with. The fourth trait that I want to talk to you about is what I've called the one-size-fits-all leadership style. The one-size-fits-all leadership style. The best leaders are fluid. They're flexible in their approach. They understand the power of and the necessity for contextual leadership. My way or the highway leadership styles do not play well in today's church world. What happens with that type of leadership, that get out of my way or get run over leadership, is we have a fractured fellowship, and it ultimately ends up in a non-productive church. The people just fall apart. It's a rough way of going. No one wants to just be pushed or pounded out of the way. You know, only those leaders who can quickly recognize and adapt their methods to the situation at hand will be successful over the long haul. You know, my way or the highway leadership styles, they may get things done this week, but on the long haul, we need people that'll get along beside of us and run with us. That's not going to happen. You got to think compromise, not control. You've got to think collaborate, not dictate. You know, this is very important. I'm just telling you, we're not in the 1940s. People are not just going to do what you tell them to do because you told them. You don't have that much clout with the people. There's been too many failures in the ministry. There's been too many scandals in the ministry, too many money-hungry, power-hungry, sex-hungry men and women in the pulpit. We've got our work cut out for us. People don't just respect you because you say you're a man of the cloth. It means absolutely nothing. And I can delegate you authority. It still doesn't mean anything. I can delegate authority. I can get people to follow each of you as leaders. They're only going to follow you for a while. They're going to stop following you if you've got my way or the highway. You've got to learn how to deal with people. I got four kids. I have to parent all four of them differently. And we've got to be that type of leader with the people. We've got to learn how to handle people, how we can deal with people, and that sort of thing. So my way or the highway doesn't work. You've got to be flexible, you've got to be fluid, and you've got to be able to adapt quickly in order to be a great leader. Toxic trait number five is you need to get invested, or a lack of investment would be the toxic trait. Leaders not fully committed to their ministry, leaders that are not fully committed to investing in those that are helping them, they're going to fail. The best leaders support their team. They build into their team. They mentor and coach their team. And they truly care for their team. It's not a selfish thing. Let's see how many people I can get to help me fulfill my vision. That's not great leadership. Great leadership cares about the people and wants to see them prosper. It wants to equip them and challenge them, instruct them, and give them the tools to allow them to be great leaders. A leader never fully invested in their ministry will not have a ministry. And if they do have a ministry, it's not going to be a very effective ministry. Never forget the old saying, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Those are words that a preacher, minister, pastor, whoever you are in leadership, you should live by those words. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. You've got to care about people. And the next thing I want to say about that, as far as being invested, you've got to own your ministry. Far too ministries fail because the leader won't own it. You know, they're busy here, they're busy there, they've got this going on, they've got that going on, they got a heart for ministry, they want to do ministry, they want to make a change in people's lives, they want to build the kingdom of God, but they're too busy, their priorities are out of whack. They've got 55 things ahead of the ministry that they're over. It doesn't work. And so they never throw their heart into it. And if they do, it's sporadic. It's, you know, hit and miss. They don't throw their heart into it. They don't give it everything they got. And their assignment is basically non-productive. So it creates a substandard ministry that's almost counterproductive to the kingdom of God. And I'm going to share something with you that I've told probably 100 pastors, 100, you know, ministers. When you go to do a ministry, you need to prepare to work alone over and over again. I've watched men and women start ministries and then get upset because everyone around them didn't drop what they were doing and help them. If you start a ministry, it's your ministry. I'm not upset because a bunch of pastors are not over here helping me build Revival Tabernacle. No, this is my ministry. I founded this church. God called me to found this church, bring up leaders underneath me, and tear this city upside down, turn it around. It's your ministry. Your ministry is not the center of the universe. The kingdom of God is. Jesus Christ is. Okay? Then there's a local church, the local assembly that God is using as a conduit. All the ministries of Revival Tabernacle should rotate around Christ and this church. Revival Tabernacle is the hub. Okay? The conduit that God is using to do this. So what happens is leaders that do own their ministry, they start thinking that their ministry is everything. It's not. Other people have other things that God has called them to do. Other people are doing what God has assigned them to do. So you need to do what God has called you to do. Don't expect everyone else to do what you're doing. It doesn't make sense. God called you to do it. Own that ministry and get busy. Your ministry is not more important than anyone else's. Get that in your head. We're all the same. We're all working for the same God, the same kingdom, going the same direction. Every preacher that has ever approached me about pioneering a church says, Pastor, I want to found a church. What do you think? I tell them, I say, it's great. But if you start a church, you and your wife need to prepare to do it by yourself. I try to explain to them, I'll come and help you when I can. I'm pastoring my own church. I got other pastors that I'm trying to help, people that have asked me, can we come up underneath, you know, the canopy of your authority? Sure. I'm praying for people. I'm trying to disciple people. I've got my own ministry. They've got their ministry. Sure, I'm going to help them when I can. If you start a church, you start a church. It's your burden. It's your ministry. And so you got to get that in your head. If you got a ministry, own it. Okay? Stop waiting for everybody else. And if the ministry can't be done by you and you can't bring anybody up underneath you, you need to reevaluate the whole situation. You need to work on your leadership skills. People will follow you if you'll lead them right. And God will bless you. So own that ministry. And my sixth and final toxic trait that I want to talk about is a fearful leader. And I guess what I call this number six, point number six, is show some courage. Don't be fearful. Don't be timid. Leadership absent courage is a farce. I'm not referring to arrogance. I'm not referring to bravado or brutishness. I'm talking about real courage. It takes courage to break from the norm. It takes courage to challenge the status quo, to seek new opportunities, to cut your losses, to make tough decisions, to listen rather than speak. It takes courage to admit your faults. It takes courage to forgive the faults of others. It takes courage to not allow failure to dampen your spirit. It takes courage to stand for those that are not capable of standing for themselves. Rebel against negative peer pressure. Yeah, you got to do that. It takes courage, my brother, my sister. It takes courage to remain true to your core values. And you can do none of these things without real courage. Courage is having the strength and conviction to do what's right when you know it would be easier to continue doing things like you've always done them. That's courage. You know, compromise is simply not doing what you know is right. You don't have to be a charismatic person to be a great leader. Okay? You don't have to be charismatic to be a great leader. Courage doesn't necessarily come in running, jumping, and dancing. You know, needing the spotlight, needing attention really hinders more than it helps. With that said, you know, although a leader don't have to be charismatic, you can't be timid. You can't be afraid. You know, the scripture teaches that God has not given us a spirit of timidity, a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So I've watched a lot of guys get upset because people wouldn't help them. And then I looked at it and I said, man, you know, they probably would help you if they knew you wanted them to help you, but you're so timid, you're so fearful, you lack the drive, you lack the passion and the fire to actually go out and grab people and say, hey, I want your help, would you help me? And then teach them how to help you. So if you're timid, people are not going to follow you. You say, oh, people don't care. Well, if you're timid, they don't know that you want them to care. So, you know, you've got two sides to that toxic leadership. You've got the brute and you've got the timid. Both of those are equally as toxic and nothing gets done. Let's get away from the negative and let's start talking about some positive traits. Let's look at a biblical perspective on leadership. The reason men fall into brutish and timid leadership styles is that they lack leadership and teaching skills. When you can't reason with people, when you can't convince them with your thoughts and ideas, you've got to manipulate them. You have to shame them. You have to create fear. And for some, simply back away and say, forget it. I'm just not going to deal with it anymore. And you leave the people alone. Well, you can't do either if you're going to be a leader. You've got to be bold as lions, but you've got to be harmless as dove and wise as serpents. It's just that simple. Paul tells us exactly how real biblical teaching and leadership, how real biblical discipleship should be done. Look at 2 Timothy 2, 24 through 26. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. This set of scriptures, these three verses, changed my life. Totally revolutionized my ministry, along with a couple of my ministerial brothers who challenged me and loved me enough to, I guess I would say, rebuke me humbly, you know, reverently. But a couple brothers and these three verses, they revolutionized everything. And I'm being molded right now, being crafted right now because of these three verses. So let's look at what the Bible says about real biblical godly teaching and leading, how it's supposed to be done. Notice that he says the servant or the minister must not strive. The teacher must not strive. The word strive means to war, quarrel, dispute, or fight. The servant of the Lord must not fight. We are supposed to convince. We are to reason. He says the servant of the Lord must be gentle. The word gentle means affable, mild, or kind. The word affable means good-natured and sociable. So the servant of the Lord is supposed to be kind. The servant of the Lord, the teacher, the minister, the leader, is supposed to be good-natured, approachable, easy to get along with, sociable. Very simple. And not only are we supposed to not strive, not only are we supposed to be gentle, but he says that we are to be gentle unto all men. You and I, if we're not real careful, we will cherry pick who we're willing to have patience with. That's a folly. You know, Paul said to be patient, be gentle, teach, be kind, be sociable with everyone. And I know that we've been taught to plow through people, pin them to the wall. But there is no scriptural precedent for pinning people to the wall. That's what demon-possessed King Saul tried to do to David. There's no precedent for that. There is, however, a precedent for speaking kindly, speaking gently, being meek and mild with people, because it wasn't too long ago you and I were messed up too, and we were in need of mercy also. We need to show mercy because we've been shown mercy. The servant of the Lord must be apt to teach. The minister, the leader, must be apt to teach. The word apt here, it means to be able or capable. And it actually goes a little deeper. It actually means to be prone to instruct. The minister is bent. The minister has a proclivity or a propensity to teach. In other words, they can't help it. You love, you care, you're so full of the knowledge of God and His ways that you just have to pour it out to people. You are bent. You have a propensity to teach people. A true Bible teacher is instructive. Now that's what the word teach there means. We are prone to instruct. The word instructive means useful and informative. These are very important words. And so what he's trying to say, when you break this text down, the minister is prone to give useful and relevant information. When you begin to teach, I know guys that can teach deep theology that no one understands. I'm not going to say it's irrelevant because I'm sure it's relevant to someone, but if you're teaching stuff and you're using terms and teaching these things that no one has any idea what it's not relevant. And I know that we're living in a time, all this talk about relevance, you know, the church being relevant, the gospel being relevant, and it's so relevant, now it's irrelevant. You know, and it's almost like folks are trying to attack the concept of being a relevant church in our culture or preaching the gospel in a sense that's relevant. Okay, if the gospel in the church is not relevant, it means it's irrelevant. Now, do you really think that we should be irrelevant? Would you say that Jesus Christ's ministry was irrelevant? No, it was pertinent. It was necessary. It was needful. That's what relevant means. The ministry of Christ changed people's everyday life. It taught them how to live, to breathe, to move, to walk, to talk, to communicate. It taught them how to exist in this world. We must instruct people. We must be bent, prone to instruct people with information that is relevant. You give instructions that can and must be used by the people in their everyday life. He says the servant of the Lord, the minister, must be patient. Another incredible word. It means, the word patient means enduring of ill, forbearing. So to be a biblically qualified teacher or leader, you must be able to endure the ills of the people, but it goes deeper. Not only should you be able to endure and teach when people are going through things, you have to be able to endure ill people. That's right, not just the ills of the people, but ill people. They've got to be taught and they've got to be saved also. The word ill means not in full health, unwell. Number two, poor in quality. And the third definition of this word ill is harmful, hostile, or unfavorable. You got to be patient with those that are sick, those that are poor in quality. You've got to be patient with those that are hostile. The Bible teacher doesn't use arrogance and anger. He is skillful. She is patient. They're like a chess player. If you can't convince your followers this way, you'll try another way. If you can't convince your followers today, you'll wait patiently for the next day that you can. It's vital that the Bible teacher leader doesn't scare the hunted off with clumsy actions, speaking too soon, or speaking too loud. The good leader, a great Bible leader, must be a master at leading and teaching. But listen to me, and this may be the most important thing that I'm going to say this whole lesson. To be led by a wonderful teacher is a great thing. But in order to lead, in order to lead masterfully, you have to be able to master your own spirit. You've got to have self-control. You can't blow up. Self-control, temperance is paramount. You've got to be able to think rationally. You've got to be able to see the issues at hand, the people at hand. You've got to be able to see your way through. How do I teach these people without being angry, without throwing bitter words and manipulating? You've got to learn to bring yourself into control and teach the people in a way that God would have you to. We are not fighting fire with fire. I know that that's what a lot of folks think. We're not fighting fire with fire, because Proverbs 15 and 1 says, a soft answer turneth away wrath. A soft answer turns away wrath and anger. But grievous words stir up anger. Fire begets fire. That's not our ministry. We're not to provoke people to anger. There's no way that you can prove that to me biblically, that you're going to win people to Christ, making them angry, you know, calling them names, ad hominem attacks against people's character. Preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. Name calling. And I'm not talking about using biblical terms like whore and whoremonger, you know, sodomites. I mean, there are words that we're going to use. I'm not talking about preaching against sin. I'm talking about derogatory terms that people use. I'm talking about shaming, manipulating, you know, pushing, pulling, bullying, because you don't have the time, the patience, or the skill set to teach people and reason with them intellectually. A soft answer turns away wrath. And we need to get that. The servant of the Lord must not strive. I don't care how you slice it or dice it. You cannot do away with that text. The servant of the Lord must not fight. The servant of the Lord must not war. The servant of the Lord must not quarrel. They should be gentle unto all people. So let's have a soft answer. Let's be kind and gentle. Number five, he says, the minister of the Lord, as he ministers and teaches, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. That's what we're doing. That's what we're called to do, to instruct those that oppose themselves with meekness. The word meekness means gentleness, humility. It is humility with strength. Think about the man Moses. He wasn't weak. The scripture said he was the meekest man on the earth. He was meek but strong, humble but strong. That's what you and I have to do. That's the manner in which we're supposed to teach and preach, with boldness, with strength, but with great humility. So he says that we're to instruct. I like this word. This text, instructing, in the Greek means to train up, to educate, or by implication, to discipline. How long does it take to train up a child? We are very familiar with that text. Train up a child in the ways it should go. Okay, that's what the word instruct means. You instruct those that oppose themselves in a spirit of meekness. And what does it mean to instruct? It means to train them up as you would a child. You don't train your children up screaming and yelling at them. You don't train your children up calling them names. If that's the type of parenting you're doing, you're going to destroy your children. Your children are not going to serve God. They're going to go into the world. They're going to do all sorts of mischief and ungodliness. If you're yelling and screaming at your children, you are the problem. You're a poor parent. You're a poor leader. And you need to go to God and repent. Ask God to forgive you of this egregious sin. And you need to teach your children, train them, slowly but surely love them and train, teach them. Don't just shove it down their throat, and because you're too impatient to continue training, back away and scream and yell and call them stupid and dumb. It's not the kids that are stupid and dumb. Same way with us ministers. You know, we've got to train the people. You don't throw a four-year-old child out on the street because he sold his underwear. You wash his underwear. You keep potty training. And although it's frustrating, and a four-year-old child should know how to use the restroom, sometimes they don't, you potty train them. You don't just discard your kids. You don't scream at your kid. Training requires time. Training requires a plan, a systematic and methodical plan. It takes nothing to yell, beat, and thrash, but it takes skill. It takes wisdom. It takes time. It takes love to train. You have to train your children. Leaders, we have to train the people, and we have to train other leaders, okay? It takes time. Who does the scripture say that we're supposed to instruct or train? Those that oppose themselves. Now, if you just read that at face value, you're going to think that that means people that are against themselves. Oh, man, they're their worst, their own worst enemy. That's true, but that's not what this text means. What that word, that phrase in the Greek, it means to set themselves opposite you, those of a different opinion. So in meekness, humility with strength, train up those that disagree with you. That might be too hot to handle for any of you guys. I know it's difficult for me. We like to cherry pick who we deal with. People that we believe that we can mold and fashion and form into our image really, really quick, well, those are the ones that we're going to deal with. But if somebody opposes us, if someone has a different opinion about things, nah, we don't like that. We kick them out pretty quick. Most preachers are intimidated by thinking, question-asking people, and they will put them out quick. Most pastors and preachers do not like smart people. Folks that have an opinion, folks that have, you know, questions, they hate that because a lot of times we're preaching and teaching and doing things we don't have any answer for. We just do it because grandpa did it. Well, we're living in a society and a generation of people that's not good enough. They want to know why. And I encourage our people to ask why. If I can't give you an answer, I don't need to be talking about it. So when someone doesn't agree with you, you don't crush them into submission. You don't excommunicate them through your preaching or through a cold and icy treatment. And that's probably the most prominent means that pastors and ministers do to eradicate people that don't think like them and don't act like them. It is wicked. God is not pleased with that at all. And you got to stop that. Just because someone doesn't agree with you doesn't give you the right to kick them out of your church. It is still our responsibility to train them with the spirit of meekness. So what is the result of gentle, patient, and kind and skillful leadership and teaching? Well, we see that in verses 25 and 26 of 2 Timothy chapter 2. He said, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. This is clear. The right kind of leading and the right kind of teaching leads people to repentance through understanding and accepting truth. And there's only one truth that saves, and you know what that truth is. I'll give you a verse of scripture to kind of emphasize it. It's 1 Timothy 1:15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Now, as we close today, I want to talk to you about our ministry leaders covenant. When you accept the responsibility of being a leader at Revival Tabernacle, you're accepting a high calling. It's not a light thing. You're stepping into the eternal. And you've got to live above reproach because you're representing Christ. You're representing Revival Tabernacle. And if you're a leader in this church, you're representing me as your pastor. You've got to be worthy. You've got to be godly ambassadors of the kingdom of God. You cannot bring a reproach to the body of Christ. I want you to think about this. Every member of Revival Tabernacle has signed a membership covenant agreeing to come underneath the authority of Revival Tabernacle's leadership. So if I've got a whole congregation of people that said, Pastor Lamb, we agree to obey them and have the rule over us, I'm going to sign a covenant agreement with them, and so are you as a leader, that states that you're going to come in covenant with them to love them and treat them right and be godly and respectful leaders. So I can't expect them to sign a covenant agreement that they're going to follow your leadership without you signing a covenant agreement saying that you're going to lead them in a godly manner. And so as ministers and ministry leaders of Revival Tabernacle, we've got 12 covenants that we have to agree to, or you'll not be a leader in this church. And so I'm going to read that to you, and we'll get out of here, okay? This is what the ministry covenant says. As a ministry leader at Revival Tabernacle, I covenant with the church to give my committed best to my position of leadership. I will strive faithfully to fulfill all the responsibilities of my position. Number one, having received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and am now living in fellowship with Him, I do hereby pledge by the help of God to do my best to serve my Lord and my church with a pure heart by helping my pastor and promoting the worship service, 2 Timothy 2:21. Number two, I am in accord with the doctrinal statement of my church and the teachings of my pastor. That's 2 John 9-11, Jeremiah 3:15, and Hebrews 13:7. Number three, I covenant to daily set aside time for fellowship with my Lord in prayer and Bible study. John 8:31, John 15:7, 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Covenant number four, I covenant to pray for my pastor and family and for the spiritual health of the church, 1 Timothy 2, 1-4. Number five, I will faithfully attend and promote the services of our church, Hebrews 10:25. Number six, the Word of God says to be His workman. I must study to show myself approved, 2 Timothy 2:15. Therefore, I will faithfully attend a Sunday school class, prayer meetings, and leadership and Christian education classes. Number seven, God's Word says, obey them that have the rule over you, Hebrews 13:17. Therefore, I covenant to walk in obedience and submission to my pastor or any person that is designated to be my leader. I will serve wherever my leader assigns me. Covenant number eight, I covenant not to allow my lifestyle to become a stumbling block to others. I will not involve myself with any kind of illicit drugs, nor will I be involved in any kind of activity that might injure the reputation of the church. I covenant to live, number nine, I covenant to live a lifestyle that is not contrary to the Word of God. I covenant to never live with a person as married unless I am legally and biblically married to that person. And that, of course, is heterosexual marriage only, Hebrews 13 and 4. I will seek to walk in the Spirit and not in the works of the flesh. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envying, murder, drunkenness, reveling, and such like, Galatians 5:19 through 21. Covenant number 10, I covenant to be obedient in my tithes and offerings as God requires in His Word. As a leader, I must align myself with the vision of giving that my pastor has set forth for the church. Malachi 3:10, Luke 6:38, Luke 12:34, Hebrews 7:6 through 10, Matthew 23:23. Covenant 11, I covenant to the best of my ability to arrange my schedule so as to attend regularly scheduled meetings of my ministry assignments. Number 12, I covenant to be on time for all services, classes, and meetings that require my presence unless hindered by reason of good conscience. I hereby understand that the preceding requirements that have been stated will be used as a criteria for my evaluation for qualification to serve the next year. I am not in this position for selfish reasons, but to give service to the Lord. All that I do heartily unto the Lord, Colossians 3, 23-24. I hereby promise before God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, my pastor, and fellow servants to be a faithful and committed leader as God requires, 1 Corinthians 4:2, Luke 16, 10-12, Matthew 25-23. If at any time a ministry leader of Revival Tabernacle ceases to keep this covenant, behaves in an unethical manner, abuses their authority, or causes division in the church, or whatever, anything related to that nature of thing, the church's disciplinary process will begin as it concerns that person. So in other words, if you begin to live a lifestyle that is bringing reproach to our church, the church's disciplinary process will then be engaged concerning you. You and I will talk one-on-one. If that doesn't work, I'll bring two more elders with me. If that doesn't work, we'll bring it before the church, the men's auxiliary board. And if you still won't comply, then you will no longer be a leader here. At that point, we will begin the disciplinary process as a church member, and the process starts over. I'll come to you personally. If you don't repent, I'll bring two or three elders with me. If you don't repent, I'll bring it before the men's auxiliary board. And if you still won't repent at that point, your membership would be revoked. We can't allow Achan to just have free reign in the body of Christ. God will pour out His wrath upon the body, and I can't afford that, and I've promised the people to protect them from that. So, to lead at Revival Tabernacle is an honor. It has to be taken seriously. The members of Revival Tabernacle must be safe from tyrannical dictatorship, regardless of who it is, including myself. I cannot rule this house with an iron fist. I can't try to be a lord over God's heritage. There has to be a system in place that will remove me, even if I'm that guy. It doesn't matter. The people are precious. God loves them, and they deserve to be protected. So, God bless each of you. I hope and pray that you've learned something, and I hope that you and I can come together in unity and pursue this beautiful art of leadership. God bless.